I boldly and faithfully declare that this is the year of opportunity. John 20:21 establishes a biblical standard that shall set the tone for this year. As God releases opportunities in my life, doors will open that no man can shut. Because of what I survived, I cannot allow others to prevent me from going where God has commissioned me to go. Every barrier that has been designed to deter me will be revealed, removed, and replaced. God's peace has given me victory over anxiousness and low self-esteem. I am a child of the Most High God. My recognition of God's anointing on my life has released me to operate fully in my gifts for the kingdom. Watch God use me. The kingdom authority vested in me will allow me to be an atmosphere changer. I am a change agent for Jesus. And because of this, I anticipate acceleration in every area of my life. Normal processes and procedures will not and cannot deny my entry. How I have handled rejection, denial, and no in my past has qualified me for opportunities in my future. As God releases opportunity for me, I will be positioned to create opportunities for others. I believe this season of opportunity will propel me, my church family, and my spiritual leadership into new levels of grace, enabling us to take more territory for the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. My giving is evidence of my faith. My giving record shows that God is a provider and I am abundantly blessed. My giving is a public record of my heart, for where my treasure is evidence of my godly affection. Father, thank you for giving me the opportunity to display my love, faithfulness, obedience, and gratitude towards you through my giving. With my giving, I break the curse of financial poverty. Through my giving, I release a spirit of favor and provision because God loves a cheerful giver. Seed, release. Lack, be removed. Harvest, return. I eat the best. I drive the best. I wear the best. I live in the best. In Jesus' name, amen.
God bless you and welcome to the Mount Chesapeake. We are excited. Can we pray? Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we love you and we thank you for who you are. First and foremost, we ask that you forgive us for anything we said, thought, or done that's not of you. Thank you for this holiday season, God, and we ask that you continue to bless and keep us in the name of Jesus. Wherever we're watching from, wherever we're looking from, God, be with us, God. Even through this season, God, thank you for keeping us throughout this year. We are grateful that we are yet alive and have the activity of our limbs. Thank you, Father, for all that you have done. Thank you for what you're doing. And thank you for what you are going to do. Now, bless this service now as we come before you, giving you praise, glory, and honor with the word from the one and only Bishop Kim Walter Brown. We love you and thank you for him and his family and all that you have done for them before us, that we may see an example of how to live. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen.
Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so holy. All he brings, listen to the angels sing. Glory, glory, glory to the newborn King. Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so holy. All he brings, listen to the Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so holy.
Lord.
always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus.
'Cause nothing else matters. Everything revolves around you. Jesus, you're the center. Nothing in this world can do. Jesus, you at the center of it all. At the center of it all. Jesus, be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be you, Jesus. Jesus, ain't nothing else. Nothing in this world will do. Cause Jesus, you're the center, and everything revolves around you. Jesus, you be the center of it all. The center of it all. Be the center of it all. Be the center of it all. Say nothing else. Center of it all. Be the center of it all. Be the center of it all. Say from my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
From my heart to the
from my heart to the must do. Oh, 'cause Jesus, you're the center, and everything revolves around you, Jesus. You be the center of it all. Be the center of it all. Jesus, be the center of it all. Be the center of it all. Center of it all.
Well, good morning and welcome to the Mount Chesapeake and the Mount Virtual. I am so excited today to be able to share with you. Hopefully you've already been blessed today. This morning at 8 o'clock, we had a marvelous Christmas celebration, celebrating the life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And then at 9 o'clock, millennials. It's amazing that my daughter, her greatest memory is not a toy, not how much money we've given her. If you listen to them at the 9 o'clock hour, her greatest memory is the games that we've played as a family. So just want to remind you, Jesus is the reason for the season. Don't go out and spend all of your hard-earned money trying to get caught up in the all of the material value of Christmas. Christmas is about celebrating the birth of Jesus. Can you imagine how you would feel if the world threw a birthday party for you and gave everybody else gifts and didn't give you a gift? So I just want to remind you that even in the midst of the Advent season, the Christmas season, God does still desire for us to honor him, honor the kingdom of God with our tithe. So right now, there are lower thirds that will inform you on how you can give today. We believe that God has blessed us in the midst of a pandemic to be able to keep you connected, to cover you and care for you. In fact, you know, my mind wonders sometimes. I have attention deficit. I'm sure I would be diagnosed if I was in school today as a child. And I sat there. Can you bless God around the world for the Mount Collective and for the Creative Arts Department? But y'all know what? I sat there and I saw Kadarius playing the box drum and the tom drum, I guess that's, you know, and he's got the tambourine and stuff. I could have been in the band all these years, because every child that went to school in the hood, at lunchtime, you were at the lunch table and turned the lunch table into a drum. You and your boys, either y'all were playing kick football with a little triangle, a piece of paper, or you were sitting there with your beat. And I'm sitting there saying, man, all these years, I did not know there was something called a box drum. I am proficient on the box drum. Woodrow Wilson High School, Harry Hunt Middle School. Boy, I can play everything you want with my two hands. I just not coordinated to play a tom, a hi-hat, kick, and all that stuff. But if I knew you could play the box drum, I would have been in the band years ago. So we just proud of the innovation of this day. Want to remind you that Christmas Eve here in this region on Sky 4, our replay of this morning at 8 o'clock will take place live on Sky 4. So please share that with everyone. Let somebody know that the Mount is on today. I want to thank you. Yesterday, I was literally out at the store and people were texting me, DMing me, and telling me that yesterday the message that was on Keys to the Kingdom blessed them. So we're so grateful to God for what he's doing. Don't forget Watch Night as well, December the 31st at 10 p.m. We will still be celebrating Watch Night. If you belong to a ministry and they don't do Watch Night, ask them why they don't do Watch Night. It would be interesting to hear their answer, because Watch Night is a cultural distinctive for people of the ethnicity of African-American ethnicity, because it was the night that our ancestors, our forefathers watched the clock, because at midnight slaves were legally free in the United States of America. We do know And it's amazing right now. I don't want to get into the politics of our day, but it's amazing that there were some parts of the nation that never got the word. There are some parts of our nation that still haven't gotten the word, but that's a whole nother sermon. I'm going to leave that alone right here at Christmas season. But we will be 10 o'clock to 12:15 on Sky 4 on all platforms. And so we're so, so excited about what God is doing. And just want to thank you as well. Watch this. You can register to win New Year's Eve cash by texting Mount NYE, M-O-U-N-T-N-Y-E, to 71441 to register. And the reason we're in the studio today is because the sanctuary has been prepped for the Christmas program. And so I'm just grateful to God for our staff's ability to be able to multitask. Now, look, we got a beautiful surprise before I get into the Word of God. I am so excited. Met this beautiful queen through the connection of her daughter. She is a virtual watcher. She's been connected to us because of the pandemic. And today we wanted to give her the blessing of not just praying with her, but being able to invite her so that she could we could pray with her personally. And so I'm excited to have Sister Brenda come. She is this great woman of God. And before her daughter connected her to us, she didn't know anything about us. And so grateful to her daughter from Northern Virginia, who put my mask on so I can be. But we just want to pray with you. We just want to pray with you because we understand it's been a challenging season. Your daughter wrote us and told us. First of all, I just want to thank her for connecting us. I believe, Sister Brenda, nothing happens by coincidence. God is a God of providence. He's ordering our steps. And according to Romans chapter 8, verse 28, everything works out for my good. Health challenges, career challenges. I'm ministering to Sister Brenda, but I hope that we are ministering to you around the world. And so while we're praying for her healing, we're praying for healing to release through her around the world. I got Bible for this. I got Bible for this. It was one woman that pressed her way that caused the virtue of healing to be manifested that day. If you remember the story, one woman presses her way through the crowd, but out of her moment, a little girl gets healed. And so we're believing that today. Daughter, you're welcome to join us. All right. So would you join us? Do me a favor. Just close your eyes around the world. Because of social distancing, I'm not going to touch Sister Brenda. But the good news is my hands don't matter anyway. I'm just the conduit that the Lord's hands are going to touch her. And so would you join us in prayer? God, right now in the name of Jesus, we pray for unusual virtue to flow today. God, we thank you for her confidence. We thank you for her daughter who has connected us in the spirit. We thank you for the staff of our church that has given us the ability, even in the midst of a global pandemic, to keep people connected to the movement of the Word of God, to care for people and to cover people. So today, we cover Sister Brenda. Saints around the world right now come together in agreement. And the Bible makes it clear that wherever two or three of us, and God, there's more than two or three of us around the world right now that stretch our hand to the television, that intercede on her behalf. And we declare her to be a walking miracle. Doctors will be astounded. And we thank you for the wisdom that they have. But we declare they practice medicine, but we know someone that is the great physician. So thank you for her obedience to give us the opportunity today to use her as a conduit to the kingdom of God. And we declare that the healing that's fallen on our dear sister today, right here at our church, is falling on sisters in Colorado, in California, in New York, in Florida, in Germany, in Africa. We declare that whatever the health challenges are around the world, right now in the name of Jesus, the virtue of God is being released. And God, we thank you in advance for the testimony, the witness. Thank you for the nurse that needs to know that you are a healer. And when she sees the report of Sister Brenda, she will know that you are God that healeth all of us. So God, we thank you for the stripes that you've already taken that appropriated her healing today. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for letting us just hang out with you, for hanging out with us. I'm usually a very righteous person. I don't typically, your daughter over there wiping stuff out of her eyes. It must be the pollen in the room. We got you here to pray, but that wasn't the only reason we got you here. We got you here because as we started to do a little research, found out that you got a water bill that's due. So we want to take care of, let me see. Let's see. Yeah. We want to take care of your water bill. Because it's a sin for a believer not to have water. Y'all around the world, that just went over your head. But hold on, hold on. Not only did we find out your water bill was due, but what kind of believer would not have water and then not have power? So we found out your Dominion power bill was due. So we want to take care of today your Dominion power bill. We appreciate you. Bless you. I didn't tell you to leave. So that's your water bill. That's your power bill. I don't know what you drove up today in, but a little bird told us you could use some help as well with your car note. So, we got your car note too. I'm trying to keep my composure too. Now you can go. Hold on. He got one more thing over there. Cause it didn't make sense for us to help you pay your water bill. I'm not gonna make it either. Not to pay your water bill, your power bill, your car note. But we can't have you having to stay in the car. So the last thing we want you worried about at Christmas time is your mortgage. So we're going to take care of your mortgage too. Thank you, daughter. Thank you, Sister Brenda. It's because of your benevolence that once again, church is supposed to change lives. Can we just stop for a moment and just thank God? Be an agent of change in somebody's life, especially in this season. No pretense. We hope we motivated other people to just go change somebody's life. And we just wanted you to know God sees you. God hears you. He has not forgotten. He will fight your battles. In Jesus' name. Bless you. Thank you. Bless you. Woo, God. I got to say this. I'm sure there are churches around the world that do tremendous things, but I love this church. I love that partners like you, because of your benevolence, give us the opportunity to do things like that. Might be somebody sitting there right now saying, watch this. I know what you're saying. Well, why did they have to do that? publicly? Well, two things. Number one, she didn't look like she was upset. But secondly, the Bible says, let your light so shine. Not that you're bragging, so that other people can see it. And then hopefully they will be moved and motivated to be a blessing in somebody's life. And so I'm grateful to God that over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be doing something for nurses. It's just going to be an extraordinary time as we end the year. So once again, to all the saints around the world, thank you. Look, want to share with you the word of God. It's found in Luke chapter 2, starting with verse 7. Luke chapter 2, verse 7. We right on schedule, so not worried about time. Luke chapter 2, starting with verse 7. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger. Y'all know the story. We tell it in Vacation Bible School, and you'll see it all over television, because there was no room, no lodging available for them. King James says there was no room for them in the inn. I want to ask a question today as we get ready to focus on the word. Why a manger? Why a manger? Father, I simply pray for anointing that will enable me to be able to make the word speak clearly. May we celebrate you above everything else in this season. Would you speak clearly to our hearts now? We claim authority to share the gospel in the name of Jesus. Amen. Y'all know I'm one of the people that's naturally inquisitive. And so as I began to look at the Christmas story, I started to ask myself, if you're Jehovah, you control the whole world. You can do whatever you desire, however you desire. Why would God choose, catch this right out there right now, nothing happens. You heard me just say that to Lady Brenda. Nothing happens that God doesn't allow to happen. There is no coincidence, no happenstance. Whatever is going on in my life, good, bad, or indifferent, God is allowing it to happen. Stay with me. I've got to hold on to the promises of the word and be confident that everything is working out for my good. So if that's the case, and I believe that to be biblical foundation, why would God allow Mary and Joseph to get to Bethlehem and there not be room in the hotel, the inn, according to King James Version? Y'all ready? Watch this. If this is his hometown, that's what the scripture says, that Joseph had to go to Bethlehem because you had to go back to your hometown to be counted in the census. Let me just say this. If I can go back to Portsmouth, my hometown, and I don't have at least one cousin, one friend, one classmate, one former neighbor, somebody, that even if the hotel is full, that I can't step to and say, can I sleep on your couch one night? Oh, I know, I see you. Go ahead and put that in the chat right now. I know that just messed you up. See, we get so deep because of the Bible that we stop being practical. Come on. Joseph goes back to his stomping ground, finds out that there is no room in the neighborhood hotel. And because there's no room in the hotel, his wife has a child and they have to sleep outside and put the baby in a manger. A manger is a feeding trough. I want you to understand, it's not because Joseph is not popular. It's not because he doesn't have some friends. God must be up to something. What is it about God, or what was God trying to show us, teach us, or establish by having the Savior of the world, the individual that will appropriate Lady Brenda's healing, be born and sleep in a manger? Come here, class. Because I've come to declare over everyone right now, you discouraged, you getting ready to spend Christmas all depressed, you despondent, because you're asking yourself, why would God allow me to be going through the stuff that I'm going through? Whatever it is, whether it's a health challenge, whether it's a financial crisis, you're sitting there getting ready to get angry at God. And I've come by today to tell you that there are lessons we can learn right from this story. I asked God the other day, I said, God, why the manger? Why would you do this? Why would you allow this? Because nothing happens that God doesn't allow to happen. He's sovereign. So if God allowed it to happen, there must have been purpose behind it, and there must be something he was trying to achieve. I want to spend just a few minutes helping you to understand why God would allow his son to have nowhere he could stay in the whole town of Bethlehem and end up outside with the camels, the donkeys, the horses, all of the animals, the sheep and the goats, and laying or sleeping in a manger. Here it is. I think the first thing is that whatever God is allowing to happen in your life, whatever God is happening, allowing to happen in my life, whatever stresses or strains or struggles that we're going through, God told me the other day that the reason why he chose a manger is because he was creating access. Oh, you still missed it. Okay, watch this. What kind of access? God said, if I had allowed Mary and Joseph to go inside, there were certain people that would never be able to access him. There were certain people that would never be able to engage the Savior of the world. I don't know who needs to hear this, but what God is doing right now, can I tell you that the reason why churches are still closed, and the reason why doors are still locked, and the reason why everything is still virtual and gone to all this technology is because it's not a curse, it's not punishment, it's not God being upset. It's God giving somebody. Okay, here it is. For all I know, I would have never met Lady Brenda today if we were still having church in the building. If it was not for COVID, maybe her daughter wouldn't have been watching online. And if her daughter wasn't watching online, her daughter would have never introduced her mom. And if her daughter never introduced her mom, I would have never had the privilege of bumping into Lady Brenda today. And if I didn't bump into Lady Brenda today, her water bill and her car note and all of those things couldn't have been taken care of. I've come to declare, stop complaining about the time. Stop being stressed about the time. And understand that what God is doing is making himself available to people that might not have ever been able to realize or receive him. If it was not for the manger, shepherds would have never been able to get that close to the Savior. Because religion always, oh God, here it is. Religion always has restrictions. That's why people are so upset with the church not being where it's supposed to be now. Because now Priscilla the prostitute doesn't have to be judged to get to Christ. Now Craig the crackhead doesn't have to worry about people looking at him side-eye to get to Christ. Now we are literally living in a season where access is granted to everybody. Can I prophesy over you to let you know that when the new year kicks off, you're going to be able to walk in some places that you couldn't walk in 2021. God is creating access. And what he does is he allows situations, stresses, and strains to manifest, not because he's trying to get us discouraged or trying to pay us back, but what God is doing is creating access. That's why I love what the Bible says. Revelation 3:20, we never look at it this way. It says, look, I stand at the door and knock. Can I suggest to you right now, girlfriend, he is knocking at your door right now. It does not matter who you are. It does not matter where you're from. It does not matter what you have done. You now have the same access that everyone else has. Don't you allow church and tradition and religion to tell you that you are out of the reach or the grasp of the Most High God. I want to let you know that he loves you. I want to let you know he has called you. I want to let you know that he still anointed you. And now God is allowing all this to happen because, number one, he's creating access. But watch this. This is what's, I love this. Not only did God have to allow the baby to be birthed and kept in a manger because he was creating access. But secondly, I love this, he was compounding assignments. Oh God, help me to get through this. What I've learned is church, religion, will always fool you into acknowledging your gifts above everyone else's gifts. Here's what's so amazing. Have you ever stopped to think about the fact that people that were tending sheep needed to be able to connect with people that were in the manger so that people around the world would hear the story? Okay, see if I can back up and show it to you. I'm preaching better than y'all putting hearts in the chat right now. Here's what's so interesting to me. If we go back to the scripture, look at verse 18. It says, that night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Now here it is, you got shepherds over here taking care of their sheep. But the shepherds need to be able to interact with the gifts of Mary and Joseph. Mary and Joseph need to interact with the gifts of Anna and Elizabeth. This season is no longer about your gifts being the only gifts that are required. In fact, I want to suggest to you that your gift alone, watch this, your anointing alone, your grace alone will never achieve all that God has ordained it to achieve, because he has called not just gifts. That's why there is no one person in the body of Christ that has all the gifts. There is no one person in the body of Christ that has all of the anointing. There is no one person in the body of Christ that has all of the abilities. What God does is makes us need one another. That's why we're one body. I love what it says right there. The Bible makes it clear. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. The human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body. I can show it to you. All of a sudden, the most important people now are the people that are behind the camera. Y'all didn't even want to know who was running the camera 2 years ago, but now you understand that if that person behind the camera doesn't understand how to zoom in, it doesn't matter how gifted you are at singing. 2 years ago, everybody was trying to become either a musician or a psalmist. Now, some of the most valuable gifts in the body of Christ are people that know how to turn the lights on and make the sound work well. Because what God is trying to teach us is there is no one gift that has the sum total of everything that's needed in the body of Christ. I don't care how gifted you are as a preacher. If you don't have somebody on the keys that can add some melody behind your word, if you don't have somebody that knows how to tell you which camera to turn to and which camera to look at, if you don't have somebody that can set the lights up so that your high yellow self is not orange on the television, you better make sure. That's why I've learned, I'm going to love everybody, I'm going to serve everybody, I'm going to believe in everybody, because we are now in a season where God is taking a gift over here and making it dependent on a gift over there and a gift over there. That's why it's time out for all this denominational baggage. What I love today about 8 o'clock is we had the Church of God in Christ bishop sitting there with his wife, because nobody can do it by themselves. You better find somebody that just loves the Lord and stop worrying about what kind of dress they wear or what kind of hair they have. If they want to lift up the name of the Lord, I can hang with them. I don't have to understand all their theology, because God took them to the manger so that shepherds could hook up with Mary, so that wise men 2 years later could bring gifts. Watch this. Elder, this is crazy. Shauna, God told me this the other day. I want y'all to catch this. He said the manger was about the endowment of Jesus for eternity. Okay, watch this. Y'all stop being so woo-woo. Come be practical. The thing that the shepherds do is everywhere they go, they tell somebody what they've seen. Am I in the book? So God said, okay, if, oh God, help me, I feel your glory. If I had let him go in the inn, the shepherds would have never gotten to see him. If the shepherds never got to see him, they would not have gone everywhere telling about him. If they had not gone everywhere telling about him, wise men from the east would have never looked for his star. If wise men from the east didn't start looking for his star, they would have never followed his star to Bethlehem or Nazareth. If they had never followed his star to Nazareth, there would have been no gold, frankincense, and myrrh. If there was no gold, frankincense, and myrrh, Jesus couldn't start his ministry and go get 12 brothers and tell them they don't need anything. Just come follow me. I want to suggest to you, everything is a chain of events. Stop worrying about what God is doing with you and ask God, what are you doing through me? Who is it that you have connected me with so that you can connect them with somebody else and connect them with somebody else? He's compounding our gifts. What if I had never met an Alex Hope 10, 12 years ago when his car got stolen? God knew, I'm connecting y'all now so that when the pandemic comes, Alice can be the person that leads creative arts. I dare you to get up in your living room and stop talking about you and start saying, God, connect me with the people that I'm called to interact. He's creating access. He's compounding assignments. But I love verse, this third point. The reason why they had to go in the manger, I know somebody get ready to get upset with me. Put some hearts in there by faith right now. Because he's not only creating access, not only compounding assignments, but he's cultivating applause. Ooh. You know what I've learned about God? God makes it clear. Listen to what God says. Some of us, this God is good all the time God is good stuff. That's true. That's the essence of God. But Aisha, I want us to hear the other side of God. God tells us, I'm jealous. God tells us, don't have no other God in front of me. I don't play sharing my applause. Don't get up there and just start thinking because I let you play or because you can sing that you can start receiving the glory. The glory belongs to me. God told me the other day, he said, I had to pull them out of the inn because if they had gotten the room in the inn, I would have missed my applause. Woo, God. I hope you caught that right there. He said, because the people that were in the inn would have never began to praise me like the people out in the field. Woo. I know I just messed you up. Maybe the reason why God pulled himself out of the building and made himself accessible to the world is because he was trying to cultivate applause. Maybe what we thought was applause in the church was entertainment. Maybe what we were doing inside the building was a fashion show. Maybe God got tired of the runway walks to the altar under the auspices of giving him praise when it was really for you to see my new dress. What if God said, I'm tired of sharing my glory with Liz Claiborne and Nine West and Red Bottoms? I'll leave you at home with your fuzzy bedroom slippers on, because then I know if you get up and praise me in the living room, you're not praising me for show. You're praising me because you realize that if it had not been for me, what I love about these shepherds is the Bible said, after they saw the Jesus that we know, they began to glorify him. They began to give him praise. I challenge you right now that if you were running when you were in here, if you were jumping when you were in here, if you were clapping when you were in here, if you were standing up when you were in here, then why are you not running at home? Then why are you not standing up at home? Then why are you not raising your hands up at home? Then why are you not clapping at home? Could it be you were trying to steal the glory? But the glory belongs to God. After all, it was God that woke us up this morning. After all, it was God that put some food on our table. After all, it was God that heals us. It was God that delivers us. Why don't we take a moment right now and just give him glory? God says, the only thing that I want that you can give me that I don't already have is more praise, more adoration, more glory. He says, so the reason why I put him in the manger is because I wanted the heavens to give me glory. I wanted the camels to give me glory. I wanted everything that ever did, Psalm 150. I wanted everything that had breath. I want to ask you a question. Squeeze your wrist. Do you feel a little bump every now and then? That means your heart is still pumping. That means blood is still circulating. How dare you sit there in the Advent season and not want to give God glory? Come on, let's join together right now around the world and begin to give him glory. He's seeking our applause. Let's do it. Isn't he doing great works? Then why don't you get up and just point to heaven and say, bravo, Jesus. Bravo for how you kept me. Bravo for how you saved me. Bravo for what you're doing in my marriage. Bravo for what you're doing in my finances. I gotta go. Why a manger? Because number one, he was creating access. Number two, he was compounding assignments. Number three, he was cultivating applause. But watch this. Number four, he was confirming authority. I said, God, I don't understand that. Verse 18, the text is crazy. Oh, God, I feel your glory in this room. Verse 18 is crazy. It says, all who heard what the shepherds had to say were astounded. Hold on. So in a moment, God took shepherds and made them prophets. You missed it. In a moment, God took shepherds and made them preachers. In a moment, Sister Shannon, God took the people who didn't smell appropriately and gave them a word. Boy, if I had time, I could take a turn right there and just say, if I was one of the rabbis or if I was one of the teachers of that day, I'd been asking myself, why did God not choose me? Why did God go get some shepherds and send them, Wallace, around the world? You know what he was trying to show us? I've given everybody my authority. See, let me tell you something as I get ready to leave you. You got to stop thinking only the pastor has authority. Only the deacons have authority. I'm not talking about authority to make decisions at the church. I'm talking about authority to represent the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We killing pastors because we think they're the only ones that have authority. Your pastor's not the only one that can go lay hands on the sick. So let me just suggest this to you. If you're watching, you might not even belong to our church. The text says, everywhere the shepherds went, the way it came out of their mouth, people were astonished. Can I suggest to you, between now and New Year's, rather than calling your pastor to go visit your neighbor, why don't you go visit your neighbor? And when you walk in your neighbor's house, why don't you pull out some oil? Put your hand on your neighbor and believe God for healing. Because God says, I've given authority to all of us. And the reason why he allowed Jesus to be born in a manger is because what he was doing was making sure that he confirmed authority. Luke chapter 10, verse 19 is my last scripture. He says, look, I have given you authority over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall be able to stand against you. We're almost at the end of a year. You've been saved for 30 years. Who have you prayed with? You've been serving the kingdom for 15 years. Who have you spoken the authority of God over? Now, please understand, I'm not saying the pastor shouldn't serve. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, look at the model. If Jesus operated by the model of the modern church, he would have never gone back to glory. Because when he was here, he was the only one feeding the 5,000. He was the only one raising up Lazarus. He was the only one opening blinded eyes. But when he got ready to leave, he declares, greater things than I did, you shall do. That doesn't mean we're greater than God or greater than Jesus. What he's saying is, I'm going to take a little part of myself and I'm going to break me off in every believer that becomes a part of the body of Christ. So, girlfriend, when you go into your grandmama's hospital room, a little part of Jesus walks in with you. When you go to court with your cousin, a little part of Jesus walks in with you. What he's doing is he's confirming that we've got authority. Nothing is wrong with having prayer partners. Nothing is wrong with interceding. But why don't you jump up right now and lay hands on yourself and say, the God in me, I declare to be a healer. Look, we almost at the end of the year. And you know what happened? Before COVID, you said, this year I'm going to get right with God. You didn't get right with God. Then COVID happened. And you said, as soon as the churches open back up, I'm going to church and I'm going to get right with God. Where we thought COVID was going to be 30 days or 3 months. And now COVID is soon to be here 2 years. And you still haven't made a move. You know what you're saying now at the end of 2021? The same thing you said at the end of 2020. The same thing you said at the end of 2019. Next year, next year, next year. Well, here's what I want to remind you. Regardless of what happens with COVID, next year is not promised to any of us. I'm going to give you an opportunity this year. I promise you that if you make a decision for Christ today, next year will be a tremendous year. So wherever you are right now, if you desire to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, what he did is he did a manger to give everybody access. We're presenting access to you right now. All you've got to do, if you desire to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, is text the word accept to 71441. If you desire to rededicate your life to Christ, let me tell you, before COVID, you were a little closer to God. But now it's been, for some of you, 2 years since you've been inside a church building and you feel like you lost your anchor. You didn't lose your anchor because the building was never your anchor. Jesus Christ is the anchor and the building is not Jesus Christ. And you want to get right with God? All you've got to do is text the word restart to 71441. And finally, you're sitting there right now around the world. You might be in Georgia, you might be in California, New York, you might be in Florida. And you're saying, I understood what he said today. He didn't just make me feel good, he gave me some principles. He answered some questions for me. I learned something today. And you believe I am your pastor, regardless of where you are. I'm so proud that our last new partners class, we had people from 5 states. We will receive you. All you've got to do is text the word mount up to 71441. Now, if you respond to any one of those 3 invitations, you're going to be given some prompts. Just follow those directions, please, so that we can continue to serve you and help you walk out this destiny. Look, we love you. We hope that you've had a tremendous day of celebrating the life of Christ. We've had great music, great worship. We felt the presence of God. We've been able to be a change agent in somebody's life. We've shared the gospel. We've listened to millennials give us their perspective. It's been a great day. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before the throne of God. To the only almighty God be glory and majesty, dominion and power. I declare that we are blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when we come, and blessed when we go. In Jesus' name. Bless you.